Good afternoon. So it's a great pleasure to have Paul Wiegmann visiting from University of Chicago, and he's going to give us pedagogical lectures on the Hofstadter problem, integrability and complexity.
Thank you. I don't really know what pedagogical lectures are, so I could be off balance between simple things and complicated things. But before we go to complicated things, simple things are good to fix. So the story which I would like to tell you is sort of a very educational story. It's about one of the most celebrated problem in various fields of physics, condensed matter, mathematical physics, number theory, representation theory, topological aspects of in condensed matter, cohomology theory, you name it. It turns out Young-Baxter equation, you name it, all in one package. And this amazing story, it's called I forgot to say, scaling, multifractals, anomalous dimensions. I can continue. It's a problem which embraced one of the most complicated and progressive ideas in physics and mathematics. So it's in the literature it goes under the name of Hofstadter butterfly. And for those who never heard about it, here what I'm going to do. I typed in Google Hofstadter butterfly and see the result. I will have in 0.37 seconds 94,000 results, and it starts from Wikipedia article and images, and we look for images. And there is no internet connection, sorry. How shall I get out of it? Can get out of this mode. How to do this? Yeah, I need somebody's help to manage this. Sorry, I tried to connect to internet, but don't know how. Maybe I have to zoom out. Just a second. Sorry, I have to connect to internet, but it's somewhere here. And I don't know how to. Yes, this is correct. Thank you very much. Thank you, I appreciate it. Okay. Yes. Let's go. Yes. Oh, gosh. That's not what I have in mind. What is this? It's supposed to be. Thank you. So one of these 92,000 results is pictures. And this is one of the most famous Hofstadter butterfly pictures created by computer in maybe 10 years ago. This colorful. And that is next to it next to it, original picture which produced by Hofstadter himself. It's here. I don't know how to move it. Yes, it's here. And he produced it in 1974 by a very primitive computer. So the story which I'm going to tell you is about these pictures. And those pictures now, you can see it on walls of different physical science institutions. And there is even commercial printing, so you can buy it and decorate your room. And there are tons of them. You can see this different kinds. And this is called Hofstadter butterfly. So I know that some of you know what it is about, but let me ask if you can raise hands for those who never saw this picture. Okay, thank you. Then I start slowly to explain what is this story about. That is a spectrum of a very simple Schrödinger equation. And the Schrödinger equation describes quite important physical problem, and I start from explaining it now. But first I have to come back to different slides. And can you also help me to do this? First let me not cross. Is this serious? Serious, so here. Uh-huh. Okay, so this problem is very simple, but let me recall elementary things which are called Landau levels. That's the following story. Suppose I have a plane and I apply magnetic field up towards the plane and put electrons on the plane. So the question, it's a quantum mechanical problem, and the question, how does this electron move? That's called Landau problems, and solutions are Landau levels. It's one of the elementary problems of quantum mechanics, but in the same time, one of the most peculiar problems. So, if I parameterize magnetic field by the gauge potential, magnetic field is up, and then the Hamiltonian for free particles is simply momentum over 2m. I put m equal 1, but that momentum is actually canonical momentum. That's a Hamiltonian. What I'm looking for is a solution of the eigenvalue problem, Schrödinger equation. And that's a very simple differential equation. Written for wave function, which depends on a point on a plane. Solution of this problem is called Landau level problems. It explicitly depends on gauge potential A, but in fact, the spectrum is gauge invariant, which means it depends only on magnetic field, not on A. But the wave function is not gauge invariant, and it will depend on the choice of A. There are many choices of A, different by gauge transformation, which produce the same magnetic field. So the wave function will depend on this choice, spectrum is not. And let me ask you, what is the spectrum? Can I ask the audience, what is the spectrum? It's the first chapter of any quantum mechanics textbook. That spectrum is called Landau levels. So if there is no magnetic field, no A, the spectrum will depend on momentum of a particle, and it's simply k square over 2, and wave function are plane waves. But if the magnetic, so the spectrum is parabolic. But if there is a magnetic field, that spectrum changed dramatically, and it depends on magnetic field. And can you recall what's a spectrum? It's absolutely elementary thing, the first, not even chapter, but paragraph of any quantum mechanics book. Sorry? That plus is natural. Yes, that's right. The spectrum suddenly becomes not continuum. That's a called continuum spectrum, because when K, when you choose momentum, to every momentum, there is an energy, and it's continuous spectrum. Choose another momentum, there is another energy, it's a continuum. But suddenly in magnetic field, it becomes discrete, and energies labeled by integer numbers would be the length of the strength of magnetic field, and in units where h bar is 1, mass is 1, c is 1, times n plus 1 half. So the spectrum is the same as for oscillator, right? How do you call it? Z plus 1 half. Right? So it's oscillator. So suddenly, the spectrum becomes just points. These points are equidistant, and the distance between these points is magnetic field everywhere. In the good units, this is called a cyclotron frequency, the distance, even if I restore H bar, C and M. And that's an equidistant spectrum. So that means if you shine light on electrons in magnetic field with an energy which is not exactly equal to this level, this light will go through, not just reflected, and will not excite any electron. So only if you come to a resonance, they will know about lights. So the spectrum suddenly discrete. Very different than without magnetic field, because if you shine light here, this light simply move electron up, give them extra energy, and emit a light with less energy, or less or more energy. But so from continuum to discrete, from this formula to that formula, and it looks like a very dramatic change. And that's called, this is called Landau levels. Of course, if magnetic field goes to zero, we must return to this thing. And that means that the distance between levels shrink and they start to feel continuum. So then the energy will be continuum. But as you can see, this is not an easy process. This is countable set, and that's simply continuum. And how countable set goes to continuum, that's an interesting question. No mystery here. Equation is very easy to solve. And one way to solve it is to choose a proper gauge. The most popular gauge, which you will find in textbook, is called Landau gauge. And this Landau gauge choose some direction on the plane, although plane is isotropic, x and y equivalent, but it's decided decidedly to choose sine certain direction we gauge in the plane. And this is called Landau gauge. One can check that curl of this A equal exactly B. And in this gauge, that operator become oscillators, become oscillatory operator. I can write it down. So in this gauge, AX equals zero. So the first term in this square will be simply 1/2 minus z over dx square, because AX is zero. But when A in the y direction, AY is not zero, so it will be 1/2 minus c over d y minus px. It's a gauge field plus square. So that's acton psi. And very simple differential equation. Solution of the differential equation found in this basis. Variables are decoupled, and one can look for the solution in this form. Where variables are separated because motion in x direction will not depend on y direction. So you do this substitution, the k is a parameter, and then equation for phi becomes simply oscillator. An oscillator. And that's a question easy to solve. It's an oscillator which center is shifted by momentum. That's the strength of the frequency of the oscillator. And that's it's easy to solve. Spectrum of the oscillator is equidistant, right? It's oscillator spectrum. And this wave function is what? What's the solution of this equation? Can I ask? It's that's the most standard equation, differential equation. So what's the solution of this equation? What's the wave function of oscillator? Sorry? Yes, Hermite polynomials. But Hermite polynomials to Gaussian. But my point is that, yeah, the major part is Hermite polynomial. Solution is Hermite polynomials. Polynomials, but they multiply by the Gaussian factor, but that's not important, but important is the solution of polynomial. I will use it. Yeah, that is this. The next point about Landau levels is that how it possible that it seems to be a mismatch between number of states. For any k, there is a state when there is no magnetic field, and it's uncountable set. But here it's a countable set. And it looks like very little number of states, but obviously the number of states must be the same, because it's so here's number of states and here number of states must be the same, but it looks like it's less. So what is the solution of this? Degenerate, exactly. Apparently, if I give you energy, I can give you many, many states for the same energy. It degenerates. And what's a degeneracy? Degeneracy is a total flux which goes through the plane. So if this is my plane and I apply magnetic field, then magnetic field times the area of this plane, it's a total flux of magnetic field. It's called phi, units of 2 pi. And that's how many states every level carry. Every level carry. But one can see it because the Hermite polynomial will depend on this parameter k, but the energy doesn't. So choose any k and you will get the same energy. So this state is degenerate. And the generation is the total flux of the system. If you worry about boundary condition, which you have to, let's consider the system on a closed manifold, say a torus, and then the total flux through the closed manifold by Gauss theory must be quantized in units of fundamental units of flux. Therefore, that number in good units is always integer, and the degeneracy of states, how many states, is also integer. It cannot be not integer. Okay, that's this first chapter from the Landau book. Now, Hofstadter problem is actually it's historically unjust to call this Hofstadter problem because before that, before him, it has been considered by many, many people, and most notably by Asbel 10 years before and Zak 10 years before. But names stick. And for reasons which you will see now. Hofstadter problem is generalization of that simple story. But now, not on a plane, but simply on a lattice. Suppose I have a lattice, crystal, say square lattice, so magnetic field is up, and electrons now not moving through the through continuum, but hopping from point to point. It can hop from here to here, or from here to here, or from here to here, or from here to here. And that's it. So it's electron jumping free, one electron, it's quantum mechanics. Jumping from one point to another point in the presence of magnetic fields. So nothing could be simpler. However, solution of this problem produce this picture, which I don't know how to return to it, which I erased. I don't know how to return to it, but we'll entertain ourselves with this picture when I. So, but you remember, it's an incredibly complicated picture. So a reason for that complicated picture is, there is a very helpful gentleman who helped me to jump from slide to slide. But now I can. Can't do this, and I'm afraid that as soon as I go to move to this direction, computer will fall asleep, right? So I must move to that direction, right? It's a pretty long distance, but it's okay. Okay, so allow me to formulate on this slide the problem on a lattice. Why the problem on a lattice is very different? For the following reason, let me explain. Now, okay, Hofstadter. butterfly. Uh-huh. Yes. So perhaps the most, the best picture perhaps produced Hofstadter by itself. And this is what happened to a spectrum. Instead of simply parabolic spectrum without magnetic field, instead of simple equidistant Landau level, same as oscillator, as soon as you put a letter, a lattice, some dramatic things happened. And the spectrum becomes extremely complicated, but very kind of aesthetically attractive. This picture aesthetically attracts many, many people. There is a philosophy, books written about this picture. And what is drawn here is the spectrum. So in this direction is, let me see, maybe there's a better one. Yeah, it's okay. In this direction, in the horizontal direction, the energy drawn, and in vertical direction, magnetic field is drawn. So, so if magnetic field is such that there is a half flux through the plaquette, flux equal pi through plaquette, then apparently there are only two bands. Oop. Then there is only two bands, one band and another band. If flux is one third of a plaquette, there are three bands, one, two, and three. If flux is one fifth of the plaquette, there are five bands. Two of them you see, and another two here, and there is somebody in the middle. Maybe it's, oh no, it's at this level. One, two, three, and one here, and one here. So the picture becomes incredibly complicated. Instead of that simplicity, which is extreme, no magnetic field, or that simplicity, which is another extreme, very big level, just distinct level, suddenly it blows up to something dramatically interesting and very different. What remarkable about this picture and why it is attract so many research and interest is it is self-similar. So if you look for a small part of this picture and blow up, you will see exactly the same picture. It's a fractal and self-similar. So once again, in this direction, it's a energy, and in this direction, it's magnetic field. Okay. So because it's on a lattice, magnetic field is periodic. If you add to flux 2 pi, you return to the same spectrum. That's why it's from here to there, it's 2 pi.
At the bottom?
Zero magnetic field is on the bottom, exactly. That's where spectrum becomes equidistant, sort of equidistant, but approaching to this, it is this, you will recover this level right here. Right here. But otherwise, it's the spectrum. So the story which I would like to tell you is about that spectrum. Now, it is known that all this... it has been proven mathematically that this spectrum is a so-called singular continuum. That's a counterset, but very complicated counterset, which nature typically doesn't produce. That simple problem, it couldn't be easier, produce one of the most complicated sets known to mankind. We know many countersets, we can construct it. There is applets which computer constructed. Countersets is a normal thing. But definition of counterset, it is a closed, nowhere dense set with no isolated points. But among counter sets, there are many classes. And one of the most mysterious is called singular continuum. Singular continuum, it's uncountable set measure zero, period. And it's not closed. That is example. And this is a mathematical theorem. How to characterize counter set? That's an interesting question, and that's my second talk about it. But it's we already quite advanced. But now I just would like to you to appreciate that problem. Now, let's put this problem, particle in magnetic field on a lattice, in terms of equation, and see what happened with this oscillator. Right? This is, if magnetic field, if particle is on continuum, it's simply oscillator. And that is kind of generalization of this oscillator, or deformation oscillator. Sometimes it's called Q oscillator, because it's related to so-called quantum groups, and they're characterized by a parameter, and this parameter plays the role of magnetic field. So you can think about is a Q-deformed oscillator, but let me put it in symbols. Yes, yes. So this picture actually demonstrates what will goes on. So I have lattice, and through every pocket there is a flux, and electrons jump from point to point. Now, how to describe it? This is written, this Hamiltonian, which I wrote in the second quantized form. C is the electron operator, creation operator. We jump from site N to site M. It's the nearest neighbors. And with some amplitude T and M. If I would like to put magnetic field there, I have to say that the amplitude of jumping from, say, here to here which characterized by the amplitude T and M, it's amplitude of jumping from site N to M, it's the nearest point. When in magnetic field, this T and M is some positive number times discrete version of the gauge field. Now the gauge field is sitting on the link, say this link, and it's a phase of the amplitude. So to say that there is a magnetic field, I have to say that product over plaquette, this plaquette P, of this E, A, and M, or product of amplitudes of hopping from N, M, must be equal to this magnetic flux through the plaquette. So there is a flux through the plaquette, phi, it's magnetic field. So through this plaquette there is some flux phi, uniform, same here, there. And the gauge field or the amplitude jumping from here to here, kinetic energy, must be such that the total product of them along the plaquette must be equal to this phi. And for the rest of the talk, I will call it Q square. This parameter I call Q square. Sorry? Yeah, I will do this now. I will do this now. But this is the only condition. So everything physics, all this picture will depend on phi or Q. Doesn't depend on the choice of A, but condition for the choice of A, such is this product. But in order to write it in as a Schrödinger equation, we need to choose A's. It's a gauge choice. But before I do it, I will rewrite it in a little bit different way. It's easy for me to use the slides. Yes. No. Okay. So this is what I wrote. One can think about the Hamiltonian as a sum of translations along a lattice. So if T is an operator which moves electron in x direction, say in x direction, Tx, and Ty an operator which moves in y direction, then electrons can hop up, down, left, right, and the Hamiltonian barely represented by sum of translations in all possible directions. The fact that there are magnetic field, there is magnetic field. impose an algebra on these translations. And this algebra is called algebra of magnetic translation. It says that if I move in direction x, and then to direction y, and then to direction x again, and then back to direction y, I must pick up this flux. Or another way to write it is Tx Ty equal to Q square Ty Tx. That is called algebra of magnetic translation. Some people called it non-commutative geometry. It's an abuse of terminology, wrong way of using this word. But it's a pretty simple algebra on translational operators. Without magnetic field, translational operators commute. You can go, you can, from here, you can reach this point in two ways. And without magnetic field, it's equivalent. With magnetic field, this path and this path will be different by the magnetic flux, which is here, which is sometimes called Aronov-Bohm phase. And this is what it is. So then the problem formally says that the Hamiltonian is sum of hops in square lattice in all possible direction, but product of two translations is not translations resulting point, but with a phase. With a phase. Right? So now to write equation, one has to find representation for this translation such that the basis group of magnetic translations. So it will be not just d over dx, and, but something else, which I will write down. Okay. Parallel to this exercise with Landau gauge, like which I did in continuum case, I also choose, say that Tx acting on psi sitting in point M will be simply shift in x direction, but Ty will be multiplication. So that shift and this multiply. Obviously, operators which obey this rule satisfy the rule of magnetic translations. Okay, having them written, I can write the Schrödinger equation on a lattice. And that Schrödinger equation will be the following. So psi initially depends on two coordinates, but now they discrete on a lattice, an x and an y. But in fact, it will be variables will be separated, like k and y, to psi, which now depends only on x, and then equation for n, for psi, which actually depends on k, will have the following waveform. Just a second, 1 second, I finish writing and we discuss. It disappears from the screen, but used to be on the screen. Sorry, what's the question? Psi y, it's just a multiplication. No, it will not commute. I'm sorry, I forgot to say m. Yes, so what this representation, psi x consists of one of diagonal matrix, which says that it shifts in one direction, so zeros. It is this formula. And that one is another matrix, which has q square, q to the 4, q to the 6, and so on, q to the -2, 1, q to the -4, and so on. That's diagonal matrix. So one is off diagonal, another is diagonal. That's a representation of this algebra, and there are many other representations. But if you choose this representation, which is called Landau gauge, we obtain this equation. This simply says that if it jumps in direction x, nothing happened, it doesn't pick up a phase. But if it jump in direction y, it pick up a phase phi. And two parts of the cosine, e to the I phi and e to the minus I phi, it's jumping up and down. So this is an analog of the oscillator equation, but now on a lattice. It's written in that box. So basically, what has been shown in these pictures with Hofstadter butterfly. So you fix it. Because it will slip. So what happened, this picture which you saw about Hofstadter butterfly, it's a spectrum of this equation. It's a very simple equation. It's a difference equation, or discrete equation for n. It's a Sturm-Liouville problem. Once you solve it, energy will depend on k and phi. But if k is chosen to be some number, that energy will be depends on phi, and that's it. Now, a few words about this equation. Obviously, how to go to continuum limit. That distance difference becomes second to the derivative. When the lattice site 1 goes to 0, that becomes second order derivative. And this cosine must be expanded, because in continuum limit, magnetic field is small, so it must be expanded, and it will be square. You keep only square of the argument instead of cosine, and that's oscillator, you see it. Okay. Another interesting limit, when you keep cosine, but replace this two terms by second order derivative. Then you will get what is called Mathieu equation. Okay. This is called Massieu equation. It's a standard equation, and the psi solution of this equation are called Massieu function. It's a transcendental function, and very little is known about Massieu equation. But it's one of the standard equations of mathematical physics. Because it's discrete, it's called almost Massieu equation. It's official name for this. Or sometimes it's called Harper equation. It's very canonical equation, so nothing could be, it's very easy to read, very impossible to solve. And once you solve it, it produces these pictures. And this is what Hofstadter did. He just took these matrices, sum them up, that's a Hamiltonian. So the Hamiltonian is another matrix. So this is matrices, this is another matrix, and he simply diagonalizes this matrix and produces this picture. That picture. Okay. So that's a story about the story which I'm going to tell you is about this, what to do, how to operate with this equation. And it's a relatively new story. There's no rules, but apparently this equation is related to representation theory of a deformed Lie group, Lie groups. And in this case, it will be so-called SL2Q group. And how it's related, this is what I'm going to say, and what's the benefit of these relations.
So you told that if the electron will hop in the x direction, and if the electron will hop in y direction. Could you please repeat that argument, please?
So the motion of electrons is described by Schrödinger equation.
So right? This
Schrödinger equation. What is Schrödinger equation? So you have an electron sitting, say, in n m point, right? Then when it's hop to x direction, okay, it's a vector. When it's hop to x direction, it's pick up a phase e to the a n n plus x. This is where it starts, where it get. When it's hop backward, it's pick up another phase, but minus n n plus x. Psi n minus x. When it's hop to y direction, it pick up that phase. And backward, that is energy times. Right? So it's basic application of. Now, as I said, A's are arbitrary, but must obey this condition, because this is only a physical object. Right? Therefore, if I choose A for my convenience, the spectrum will not change. Wave function will. So I choose A such that this is one, it's this term. This is one, it's this term. But these two form cosine.
Sir, that's what I was about to ask. Sir, since we have a magnetic field in the z direction and we have a lattice which is symmetric along x-axis and y-axis, right?
Z direction, right?
Yeah, and we have a lattice, two-dimensional lattice, which is symmetric.
Here.
Yeah, which is symmetric along x-axis and y-axis. So intuitively, we should expect that the solution or the result should be symmetric along x-hopping or y-hopping. Isn't that
it
so?
Yes, it's absolutely symmetric.
But it's forming a cosine.
That's what I'm trying to say. Tell you that the wave function, there's solution consists of two data, spectrum, and it's symmetric. It's a spectrum.
Okay, spectrum.
Wave function depends on the choice of the gauge. If you choose non-symmetric gauge, as I did, the answer will be not symmetric. If you choose another gauge, the spectrum will not change. Wave function will, it will be another.
So
in a sense, rotation lattice of the lattice x and y, it's one of the gauge transformation in the system. You can choose that gauge. I choose the simplest gauge to produce, and the most popular gauge, which produce very simply looking equation. Yeah. Later you will see that this is the most inconvenient gauge. The equation looks nice because it's related to Massieu equation, it's almost textbook. But for solving it, it's very inconvenient gauge. But the spectrum doesn't depend on what gauge I choose.
Okay, thank you.
So you can, these A's are basically arbitrary, they only must obey that condition. Okay. Now, we have 20 minutes. It's fine. No, I'm looking for the timing. Sorry if I bored most of you. Jumping to complex things is easy, and they will come very fast. I just would like to explain simple thing slowly. Yeah, that's fine. So one thing I would like to say is the following. Why is the problem is so complex? See, if magnetic field, if flux through plaquette is a rational number, which I use through all this talk, I use this parameterization. So this is pi, and this is two rational numbers, two integers. What happened? Oh gosh. Keep playing with this, right? Yes. So let me explain essential point of this story. If phi is a rational number, namely ratio of two integers, say 1.5 or 1.3, 7, 13. Then when I construct these matrices, q to the 4, q to the 6, and so on, eventually it starts to repeat itself when it comes q times. So these matrices are finite dimensional, and they are q by q matrices. Q by q matrices. They're finite dimensional. Therefore, for this case, to solve this problem, is equivalent to diagonalizing Q by Q matrix, and computer easily do this, produce Hofstadter pictures. Sorry? Finite. Everything finite. It's both are Q by Q. You can see it in the following way. So when N shifted by Q, it's a periodic potential, and it's repeat itself. What's the period of this potential q? Right. So if n shifted by q, it's actually nothing happened. Right. So although I'm thinking about infinite lattice, it's only q by q part of the lattice. Ah, by the way, important application of this equation. You can think about electrons in one-dimensional chain. Not in two-dimensional, but one-dimensional chain, hopping from here to here, but living in the periodic potential. Right? It's a very, very simple story. So you have a crystal, and electron jump from point to point, but there is on top periodic potential. So that if these two periods, periods of the potential and period of the lattice, a commensurate, which means that this is a rational number, That's simply a crystal with two periods. But if it's incommensurate, this is called quasi-crystal. And this simple equation also describes another subject in physics, which is called quasi-crystal. The quasi-crystal is only that, nothing more. It's a one-dimensional quasi-crystal. Okay. So if it is a rational number p over q, then basically we're diagonalizing q by q matrices, producing that picture. But the most interesting case is what happens when p goes to infinity, q goes to infinity, but the ratio stay fixed. For example, if it is golden mean, what happens if it is golden mean? Then this period, 1, and this period are incommensurate, and the matrices becomes infinite dimensional suddenly. Right? So that means, Schrödinger equation in periodic second order differential equation in periodic potential produce spectrum of it. It's a standard Sturm-Liouville problem, and spectrum of it consists of Q bands. Q bands. And Q gaps. It's only a finite number. When we go to limits when lattice could be neglected, each band shrink to a point and become a level. A number of them goes to infinity. But if this number is good number, right, 1/2, then it's only 2 bands, 1/3, 3 bands. For example, let's consider the case when p over q is, say, 1/2. Then I have 2 bands only, 2 bands. We saw it on this picture. But if I change it a little, adding, for example, this small number here, the flux magnetic field is almost not changed because it's very small. However, the number of bands blows up, and now it's about 250. So you can see that the problem depends on arithmetic, not on the value of p divided by q, but on the number theory. How about this commensurate gain? So, see, I almost not change it, but the number of gaps knows only about numerator, doesn't know about denominator, doesn't know about numerator, so it immediately blows up. Therefore, on that picture which I show, when you choose magnetic field 1/2, very close to it, arbitrarily close, there is infinitely many gaps. And then again, small number of gaps, and then again, infinitely many gaps. And so on. But the most interesting question, what happened when the ratio is not integer, but irrational? Then apparently, every band shrinks to a point, and to another point, and to another point, and to another point, but gaps also shrink to a point. So it's, and that is this counter set singular continuum when number of bands shrink, but gaps also shrink. Not all of them, but some. And I don't want to play with this computer any longer, but when I finish, we can see on the picture how that happened. Okay, the system which has bands and gaps called a metal, copper, organized this way. So if I put chemical potential in this conducting band, there is a current, it's a metal. Or insulator, if I put chemical potential in the gap, it's an insulator. But when bands and gaps shrink to zero, it becomes infinitely many. It's neither conductor, neither insulator. It's a kind of thing which, quasi-crystal, one can say, or this magnetic field, or this Hofstadter problem. And what's the property of this? If you're given a wire with that property, let's try to conduct current. Nobody knows what happened, because it's neither a metal nor insulator, because the spectrum is that complicated. But if you touch it little, it immediately becomes either conductor or insulator. You touch it again, it's very sensitive in a sense. Okay? So the major problem in this business is how to describe irrational numbers. And only understanding that tells you why one picture, why this picture is so fractal and so kind of aesthetically appealing, why it is like Russian doll, one doll inside another doll inside another doll inside another doll. Because after that happened, when they shrink, that part of the spectrum and that part of the spectrum becomes almost indistinguishable. There is a scaling. Okay. So this clock will stop working. I have time. Okay, so I stop with this introduction, and let me show you some small piece of mathematics. So, as I said, that when I deal with a continuum case, analog of this equation is oscillator, and oscillator has wave function of oscillator. Are Hermite polynomials. So the question is, why solutions of that equation are, in continuum case, are polynomials? That's what I would like to explain. Because solutions of that equation are also polynomials, in some sense, and that's what I would like to say. But first, we have to understand why solution of the original equation in continuum case, Hermite, oscillators, are Hermite polynomials, are polynomials. Once we understand that, we try to bring this knowledge to deal with discrete equations. But first, let me ask you, is there any reason how to know that if I write you a differential equation, use this part of the blackboard. So if I write you a differential equation, for example, the Hermite equation, that's a spectrum. It's a Hermite equation for psi of x. How do you know in advance that solutions, it has two solutions, one of them polynomial, another is transcendental. But how do you know that this equation has a polynomial solution before solving or opening a book where it's written? And so solution of this equation is Hermite polynomial, right? Psi is equal to Hermite polynomial. It's a polynomial of degree n. It has roots. And for that solution, lambda is simply n. So somebody tell you if lambda is integer, then solution is polynomial. Why? And degree of polynomial is exactly this integer. How do you know that in advance? So apparently people know this in advance, because this equation is related to representation of SL2 group. And solving this equation or finding representation of SL2 group is the same story. And we know it by oscillator, from oscillator in quantum mechanics. But let me put it in some framework which will be convenient to generalize for that equation. The framework is the following. SL2 algebra consists of three generators, which I write in Cartan form. And the commutation relation between them of familiar. Right. So three generators obeying this commutation relation is a basis for the ring of elements of SL2 algebra. It's okay. This algebra has a representation in terms of differential operators. That's an operator acting on a function which depends on one parameter z. And if you commute them, you see that they obey those relations. So these three operators is infinite dimensional representation of SL2. This parameter g, once chosen integer of half integer, so these relations obey regardless of j, for any j. But if j equals chosen to be integer and half integer, representation is finite dimensional. And if it's finite dimensional, the space where this operator acts could be represented by polynomials. And then I would like to explain that. Okay, so this is a simple fact from the book. And now let me consider Heisenberg Euler top. Euler top in magnetic field. Right. So it's a bilinear product of, it's an operator, it's a bilinear product of elements of SL2 algebra acting in envelope algebra. Okay. Now, if J is chosen finite, integer or half integer, I can equivalently think about these spins with this operator as a matrices. Therefore, these are matrices, and this is also a matrix. So I can diagonalize the matrix. But if I think about them as a differential operators, this is a differential operator. Where A, B, and C are built from this momentum of inertia of this top and the external field. Okay. So what I know by fact is, and there is a theorem, that if S are chosen such that J is integer and half integer, And this J will eventually come in construction of this B and C. Then the theorem says that eigenvalues of these operators are polynomials. Polynomials of the degree 2J plus 1. Is this okay? Physically, it's intuitively, it's almost obvious, because you can write them in, as the differential operators, but they are actually matrices, finite dimensional matrices, where J is their size, J to J plus 1 is their size. Therefore, this is also today, it looks like an operator, but it's actually matrix, finite dimensional matrix. And that means that solution must be characterized by finite number of data, and this is polynomials. So the fact that this equation solves in polynomials simply means that it belongs to that class. This class is rather restrictive. If you write arbitrary A, B, and C, most likely it will not, there will be no solutions in terms of polynomials. But if you produce A, B, and C from here, assuming that J is integer, half integer, there is a guarantee that one solution is polynomial. So Hermite polynomial fall in that class. And hypergeometrical, all polynomials which you know related, which related to this Sturm-Liouville problem fall in this class. So it's essential to understand that the fact that solution of some equations are polynomial, truncated series, it's because somewhere there is an underlying SL2 group. You don't see it, but it's there. So you're actually solving not differential equation, but a big matrix. How big is this matrix? You have to find it from here, but apparently it's n by n. This is also related to matrix representation of quantum mechanics. Is this okay? It's a is okay? Yes. So once you know that it is solutions are polynomial, maybe yeah, thank you. Yeah. So once you know that solutions are polynomials of this equation, you can write the roots of this polynomial. And I would like to demonstrate it. It's a very simple exercise, but useful, and allow me to demonstrate it. So, okay. So I'm looking for solution of this equation in terms of polynomials. Polynomials means that this n is finite, just number. Okay. So I plug it in and see whether it fits. But before I plug it in, I need some formulas. Second. Formulas are the following. Okay. So first of all, if I take psi divided by psi and use this formula, I will obey sum over 1 x minus x l. Is this clear, right? So I differentiate. It's like taking one of this monom out and divide. But if I do psi double prime, divided by psi, that will be sum over okay, just algebra. So you can see that it's a second pole, but here it's also second pole, and they cancel each other. So it's a single pole. For k equal l, it's a double pole, but it's also double pole. They cancel. So all this is a single pole. Now I would like to substitute it here and here. This term, now this term. Okay. So what I did, I divided by psi and substitute. This is what I get. Okay? Okay. Now I see that if I send x to infinity, so look, this is a, this on the left-hand side, I see rational function, function which has poles, single poles. But on the right-hand side, I see a constant. Right? So, that means that residues of this rational function must be zero, otherwise it's never constant. So we can first check residue at infinity. If I send x to infinity, this dies, but this x divided by this x doesn't die, and if x infinity, I can neglect by the roots, and it will be n terms, so the result of this is infinity, it will be x cancelled with this x, it will be n. Therefore, lambda must be n. And this is eigenvalues. Okay, poles in this finite part of the planar, so residue must be also zeros. So you compute residue from here and equate to residue from here, and get equations which was known for the roots, which was known to Hermit. Roots of Hermite polynomials obey this equation, which simply means that I have to compute residue from here, of here, and this is residue is this, and compute residue of this stuff, and this is a residue, and that's the algebraic equation. It's L equation, it's N equations, as many as. So computer can solve this equation, find the roots. Those equations are transcendental, but they exist because of underlying SL2 symmetry. So this equation and SL2 symmetry is one way of writing representation, develop representation of SL2. It's maybe not canonical way, but that's the way. So this is SL2, finite dimensional representation of SL2, and that equation. Okay. Now another form of this equation is that this equation apparently are degenerations, this kind of equation, degeneration of so-called Bessel-Ansatz equations, which appears in quantum system, in quantum integrable system, but that's a limit of degeneration of them. So, now I would like to extend that story to difference equation. Suppose now I have not differential equation, but a difference equation. It's a functional equation where Q represents a shift of variables, one direction, another direction. So why is this equation important? If I choose Z to be Z Q to the N, and choose psi, called psi, chosen at that point, psi n, then this equation will be a difference equation. And this equation I am interested. With a specific choice of A and B. Okay. Therefore, the question which I would like to raise is under which A, B, and C, the difference equation has polynomial solution. Not for A, B, C, arbitrary A, B, C, but for specific A, B, C. Right? If that happened, we will call this equation integrable and the spectrum is algebraized. So, remarkably, that Hofstadter problem falls to this category. And therefore, its wave function are polynomial, and I can determine their roots. And this beautiful picture of Hofstadter is basically shows these roots. So, yeah, I have to stop now, but would like to say a comment. On the example of differential equation, second order differential equation, so we raise the question under which A, B, C it's polynomial, solutions are polynomials. We understood that it's because it's related to Euler top. And because it's related to finite dimensional representation of SL2. And what's an analog for that for difference equation? Apparently, that is that symmetry is called SL2Q. And operators for SL2, generators for SL2, okay, yes, plus minus, reduce to another, follow to another operators, which called ABCD. And they form so-called SL2Q group. I will write down mutation relations. And stop. Now, it so happened that if, this set of computational relations for some reason called quantum or Q-deform SL2, it's a generators. Any product of them will be element of SL2Q. Now, when Q goes to in 1, those commutations relations are such that A minus D divided by Q minus Q1 goes to S3, B goes to S plus, and C goes to S minus. In the limit. So this set of relation generalize SL2 algebra. Okay. And the theorem stays the same and as in differential equation case. If you consider an operator which built from this S A B C D is a quadratic form, a linear form, it produces difference equation whose solution will be polynomial if you choose a representation of this A, B, C, D finite dimensional. And that's the property of this equation. And it's pure miracle. But once it's understood, it gives a very powerful tool to find solutions. And that's what I will discuss next time. But the logic is that it's a particle in magnetic field on a lattice, produce some equations, difference equations, but somewhere behind them stays this SL2Q algebra. Not only the algebra, but finite representation of this algebra, which means that there is a way to find solutions of these equations, and these solutions are in polynomials, they're finite dimensional. Polynomials characterized by roots. Roots obey some equation of this kind. Equation could be solved. And this is what Hofstadter saw on his picture. He actually saw the roots. Didn't know it. He just diagonalized matrices. But what he saw is actually the roots. And that would be my talk tomorrow.